begin with the scripture reading. A reading from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 1, verses from 18 onwards, verse from 18 to 25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man, and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to send her away quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgins shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. God our Father, we thank you for this beautiful day on the feast of Saint Bartholomew, whom your son called him as an innocent Israel. He was called so that he would know your son and follow him more closely. Today we have gathered here at the second webinar series on Saint Joseph, reflecting on Joseph named Jesus. This naming tells us that we also have been named and called by you specially. As we thank for this gathering, let us pray that you may shower our Holy Spirit upon the speaker of the day, Most Reverend Dr. Anthony Sami Peter, the moderator of the day, Mrs. Philomena Arakyaswamy, and all of us gathered here, so that this evening may be a learning, evening of learning, sharing, and interacting. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Your Excellency, well, and your Father, may invite Father Maria Arul Raja to welcome the gathering.
Good evening, friends. Good morning, friends. Good evening. Good afternoon, friends. You know, in the name of our Holy Father Pope Francis, we are very much gathered here, because it was he who inspired us with this particular gift of walking with Joseph, silent Joseph, meticulously taking care of the family, and also silently listening to the word of God and silently executing without much ado. And we are celebrating the silent mysticism, assertive mysticism, and also productive mysticism, and also contemplative mysticism, apostolic mysticism as well. In all combination, we could think of the characteristics of Saint Joseph. True, he is silent. His characterization in the Bible is very, 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 very at the lowest, even from a point of your documentation. But, you know, here comes an expert biblicist bishop, one who is excavating all the interior layers of the consciousness, collective consciousness of the biblical world, and presenting to ourselves. And I think in the CBCI, we can just locate the Bishop Abir as the very energetic Bible scholar who comes out with his beautiful insights. And it's a rare gift for us. It's a rare gift for us. I welcome Bishop Abir for our session. And my dear friends, this is the series, webinar series, conducted by CCBI in collaboration with the Spirituality and Dialogue Commission of Jesuit Chennai Province. So for these 6 months, we have been conducting this series. This is the second in series. We go till December with the different themes with a biblical phase. And towards the end, we'll have a portrayal of St. Joseph from the literary work of Veerama Munivar Thembavani from the Tamil epic. Now, at this particular juncture, I welcome Dr. Yesu Karunanidhi and our beloved moderator today, our beloved moderator who is a biologist, beloved moderator today who comes here as a moderator for us today. I'm profusely delighted to welcome all of you, starting from Thomas Surin, Stephen Francis, Sister Shobha from Andhra, and Savarinathan, Sahairaj Arikasami, Rama Devi, Prasanna Rani, Father Michael Amalas, a theologian, Michael Alasane, the spiritual leader, Mary Joseph, Mary Divya, Maria Therese, Lucia Das, Lucille Das, Lorenzia Kalko, Kalani Sami, and Zubi, Josephine, Sen, Jesusak, Jeevaratinam, and Glenn Mascarenhas, Divya Joseph, Devaputran. It is ecumenical also. He is the Devaputran, is a CSA pastor, and Clarama, and Birola, and Philo Arok, our moderator, and Binita Surin, Bidia, Arul Vimala, Sister Aurekya Mary from Gonzaga, and Anbiam Cube, there is one particular Anbiam entry, Albert Cecil Ryan, one who is hailing from Kadalur area, and many are joining us. I welcome you profusely. Let's listen to the word of God through the articulation of Bishop Abir. Welcome all of you.
Now may I introduce the moderator of the day. I have the pleasure of introducing the moderator of the day, Mrs. Philomena Arakesami, born at Kadiyapatti, lives in Madurai. She is the spouse of Mr. Arakesami Pakyanathan, auditor, mother of two daughters, a teacher by profession. After her service for the students at Vikasa in Madurai, she has continued to train teachers in various places. And she is a YouTuber and blogger. Biology with Phil Arok is very famous. She is a devout Catholic and a personal admirer and follower of Saint Joseph, who is the patron of her parish. I welcome her on your behalf and hand over the floor to her. Now to Mrs. Philomena Arakesami. Amma, you can unmute. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Father, for the nice words. Your Excellency, Most Reverend Dr. Anthony Sami Peter Abir, the Chairman of the CCBA Commission for Bible and the Speaker of the Day, Reverend Dr. A. Maria Arul Raja, the Director of the Jesuit Chennai Province Commission for Spirituality, dear fathers, sisters, and friends, good evening to you all. At the outset, let me welcome you all to this joint webinar on St. Joseph. We have an eminent personality in the person of His Excellency, Most Reverend Dr. Anthony Sami Peter Abir, as the speaker of the day. His academic laurels include master's degree in Biblical College at St. Peter's, Bangalore, licentiate in Sacred Scripture in Biblicum, Rome, and doctorate in Biblical Theology at Gregorianum, Rome. He is the pioneer of creative Bible apostolate in Tamil Nadu. He has contributed a lot to Bible apostolate when he was director at NBCLZ at Dindivanam. He is the founder of the Emmaus Center as well in Velupuram. As the deputy secretary to the Tamil Nadu Bishops' Council, he undertook new initiatives. I could personally witness his erudite scholarship during our visit to Europe. Currently, he is the Bishop of the Diocese of Sultanpet and the Apostolic Administrator to the Archdiocese of Pondicherry, Cuddalore. He is also the coordinator of the Catholic Biblical Federation of South Asia. May I invite His Excellency to share his wisdom and knowledge on the theme of the day, Joseph named him Jesus. A practical information, the speaker will have 45 minutes for his presentation, after which the floor is open to the participants for 15 minutes for discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Philomena. Dear Reverend Fathers, brothers and sisters, Good morning, good afternoon, and also good evening. As Father Arul Raja started with a silent Saint Joseph, we cannot but name him. Saint Joseph is a man in the shadow, also stands tall in the history of salvation. Silence is the image given to him by the evangelist. No speech of his, nor any words of his, this saint is heard of the Holy Family, head of the Holy Family is not recorded. Yet he played a vital role in God's plan of salvation. Most depictions of the Nativity place Joseph either at the margins or in the background. In several Christian arts, he is absent. And in most, he is a fairly old man, Michelangelo's Sacra Familia. Among the Gospels, Joseph is not mentioned in Mark. And in John, his name is used only as the surname of Jesus, as is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? Joseph takes an active role only in the Gospel of Matthew and Luke. In his infancy narratives, Luke shows the active role of Mary in interacting with the angel Gabriel, visiting Elizabeth, even singing the Magnificat. But Joseph's name occurs only passingly. Instead, my dear brothers and sisters, Matthew places him center stage in the first two chapters. Joseph soon disappears from the scene. After Jesus teaching in the synagogue of Nazareth, the people wonder, is this not the carpenter's son? Although Matthew does not record any of Joseph's direct speech, he mentions he named him Jesus, Matthew 1:25. So my analysis will be centered around this verse 1:25 of Matthew. Jesus of Nazareth and Christ of faith. We know Jesus of Nazareth is a historical person. We come to know that he was born of a woman, Galatians 4:4, while Quirinus was the governor of Syria, lived in the house of Joseph in Nazareth, and received as a Jewish child circumcision, and that he was called Jesus of Nazareth. In the statement of Philip, the historical Jesus and the Christ of faith are fused together. We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus son of Joseph from Nazareth. The expression son of Joseph is the normal way of distinguishing this particular Jesus from others of the same name at Nazareth. In John 6:42 or Luke 4:22, we read, when he is called son of Mary, it may be an insinuation of illegitimacy, according to Raymond Brown. However, in his days of ministry at the foot of the cross, and even in the past post-resurrection community, his mother is found, and it is very evidently expressed as his mother, but nowhere do we see his father, Joseph. In his book, Jesus Before Christianity, Albert Nolan explained very elaborately who Jesus was before he became the object of Christian faith. In fact, as he says, faith in Jesus is not our starting point, but it will be our conclusion. It is not easy to know the real Jesus as the account of the four Gospels are the post-resurrection experience of primitive Christianity. John Myers speaks of that in that line. They are reprojected Easter stories. What the Gospels account is mainly the witness of the apostolic communities about Jesus. Jesus is revered predominantly as an eschatological prophet, the Davidic Messiah, Son of God, and Lord and God. Even outsiders spoke about Jesus as Son of David. Jesus, use of Abba for God, indicates that he might at times have alluded correlatively to himself as Son, precisely in reference to the future consummation. Even the title Son of Man for Jesus, although some think that it refers to all three senses found in the synoptics, earthly ministry, death, resurrection, and future exaltation, these three dimensions, comes from a midrashic activity of the early church, or from the theology of the Reductus. Leon therefore rightly observes, Jesus is the name ordinarily used by the Gospels to designate Christ and to relate his activity. Son of David was a messianic title. Those who used it to refer to Jesus were identifying him as David's promised descendant. When David set out to build a temple for the Lord, Yahweh promised, "When your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom." 2 Samuel 7:12. The fact that this was to take place after David's death indicates that someone other than Solomon was in view. As a son of Abraham, Jesus brings the blessings of eternal life to all nations. Anyone who trusts in him will be forgiven. As the son of David, Jesus is Israel's promised Messiah and King. He will one day sit on David's throne and reign in Jerusalem. His rule will extend throughout the entire earth and will never end. Isaiah 9:7. We have to assert that Joseph plays a vital role in Jesus getting this title, Son of David. Now we will know who is Joseph, first of all. Matthew's Gospel, the Gospel of Joseph, so to say, starts with the genealogy of Jesus. Sobrin expounds that in the biblical world, there are various types of genealogies, ethnic or popular genealogies, biographical genealogies. Moses, Aaron, and David, are juridical genealogies, that is Esra in Esra and Nehemiah. In the book of Esra and Nehemiah, the genealogies are indented to safeguard the purity of the nation by which the Israelites of Palestine will then appear as sons of Abraham and consequently as heir to the promise. Furthermore, genealogies were indented to preserve the purity of the nation, also involving the ancestry of the Messiah. Biblical genealogies are literary compositions, juridical in character, rather than documents for archives. The main purpose of genealogy in Matthew's Gospel is to show Jewish readers that Jesus is heir to the promises made to David and kept alive in Judaism. He is also heir to the wider promise of blessings to the Gentiles made through Abraham. In Matthew's view, the two ancestors, David and Abraham, that appear very constantly in his genealogy, and their ultimate offspring, that is Jesus, are evident of God's planning. Raymond Brown asserts that the genealogy is not a record of man's biological productivity, but a demonstration of God's providence. In Matthew's genealogy, in the pre-monarchical section, from Abraham to David, we are shown how the divine selective process produced the Davidic mission, Davidic line. Jesus is Abraham's son, not through the older Ishmael, but through Isaac. Jesus is Isaac's son, not through the firstborn Esau, but through Jacob. God's providence is very clear here. Matthew opens his gospel by calling Jesus the son of David, son of Abraham. This is a statement about Jesus' human lineage. This genealogy links Jesus to two of the foundational promises of Old Testament. First, God's promise to bless all the nations of the earth through Abraham's offerings. And second, his promise to give one of David's descendants an eternal kingdom. We learn from the Genesis account that within the title of Judah, it is to the house of David that the scepter is entrusted. And so, the first section of Jesus' ancestors comes to a triumphant close with David the king, who by the grace of God succeeded Saul. In the second section of the genealogy, Matthew lists the kings of the Davidic line who reigned in Jerusalem. Matthew notes Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called the Messiah, Matthew 1:16. While Luke has the following expression, Jesus was the son, as was thought, that is the idea he gives, Jesus was the son of Joseph, son of Eli. The genealogy given by Luke runs via Joseph, the assumed father of Jesus, all the way to Adam and finally to God. We come to the conclusion, ultimately, Jesus is son of God. From the literary perspective, the motive of fatherhood of God frames the assumed fatherhood of Joseph. Matthew lists descendant from Abraham to Jesus, giving importance to the primitive Christian beliefs that Jesus is a son of God. He establishes this both in the structure and the name list, placing Joseph as a son of David. The Jews would have recognized this from genealogical list that Jesus had the legal right to inherit the throne of David, which was an essential component if Jesus was truly the Messiah. Having indicated the above purpose of Matthew, my dear friends, linking Joseph to the lineage of Abraham and David, it is to be noted that in both genealogies, Joseph is now linked directly as the father of Jesus. Both suggest that Joseph is not the physical or the real father of Jesus. This is the consequence of the primary Christian's faith in the virginal conception of Mary. Both Matthew and Luke are careful to hold this faith, and therefore, while Matthew ends his genealogy as Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, Luke begins his genealogy as he was the son, as was thought, of Joseph, son of Heli. But both are firm to say that Jesus was born of Mary. Now we will analyze who is Mary in this Gospels. The famous saying of St. Augustine is a clear witness to Mary, ever virgin. Mary, St. Augustine's words I quote in Sermon 186, Mary remained a virgin in conceiving her son, a virgin in giving birth to him, a virgin in carrying him, a virgin in nursing him at her breast, always a virgin. The belief that Mary remained a virgin before birth of Jesus is based on the Matthew and Lucan Gospels. Matthew mentions that Mary had been engaged to Joseph. The Greek term neustasis, that means was engaged, in itself would indicate the virginal state of Mary, because in Jewish custom, a girl who was not a virgin would face the condemnation of an adulteress, which is short of Mary, marriage. We know from the other Mishnah, all these laws. Moreover, the alteration of Joseph's Isaiah text, the young woman Alma is with child, made by Matthew as found in Septuagint, virgin Parthenos, shall conceive and bear a son, indicates the early Christian belief of Mary being a virgin before Jesus' birth. The same notion is confirmed very clearly by Luke in the Annunciation narrative, in which he mentions thrice the word virgin in relation to Mary. Both these Gospels agree that Mary, a virgin, was betrothed to Joseph before giving birth to Jesus. Mary was a virgin. This shows the belief of the early disciples of Jesus about this reality. Perpetual virginity of Mary is not directly attested in the infancy narratives. It is suggested by Luke, by Matthew 1:25. Therefore, we have to understand that Mary's perpetual virginity, indicating her virginity even after the birth of Jesus, virginitas postpartum, was also the intention of the evangelist. Raymond Brown comments on the text. She had no marital relations with her until she had born a son, unquote. That in English, when something is negated until a particular time, occurrence after that time is usually assured. But in the Greek term, heoskou, after a negative, this verse gives no information what happened afterwards. Luke mentions that Mary gave birth to a son, her firstborn. Here, the Greek term prototokos, that means firstborn, in no way implies that the Virgin Mary subsequently had other children, but rather stressed the dignity and right of the child. Paul Hofner, in his book, The Mystery of Mary, opines that the word firstborn is used in a way parallel to what is found in the letter to Hebrews. He brings Hebrew, I quote the Hebrew letter to Hebrew, he brings the firstborn into the world. It is to be understood as the word only Son of God and Jesus Christ, only Son of Mary. Also, taking into consideration the brothers of Jesus in Matthew 12 and 13 also, as stepbrothers or cousins, which is we know from other proto-evangelium of the Gospel of St. Peter and so, we shall hold to the belief that Mary remained a virgin even after the birth of Jesus. Now, it is a paradox. The genealogy of Matthew is a paradoxical in that it proves Jesus' Davidic genealogy through Joseph, and yet Matthew claims that Joseph was not Jesus' physical father. Jesus is expected Messiah in the line of David, is the Davidic Messiah, and this Davidic line should proceed from Joseph only as he is from the family of David. But Jesus is not the physical son of Joseph, as Jesus was born of Mary. However, that which is begotten in her is by the Holy Spirit. Now, Mary is said to be Jesus' mother because of a miraculous conception, not by Joseph. If Joseph is not the father, how then can this his genealogy apply to Jesus? Problem. Joseph's naming of the baby constituted legal recognition of the child as his own son. Hence, in Matthew 1:18-25, it is implied that Jesus is not the legal son of Joseph and therefore not of David's line, but also not Emmanuel. In order to solve this divine paradox, I call it divine paradox, God's occasion is given to Joseph, you shall name him Jesus. Significance of naming a child. There is a Hebrew saying recorded in the Bible to indicate that a person's name can illustrate his or her character. Kishma ken hu. That is, like his name, so is he. 1 Samuel 25:25. If, for example, a woman's name is Rina, meaning song or joy, and she is a musical person, one might use this saying to indicate how appropriate her birth name is in retrospect, looking back on her life from the present. The name is not merely a sign that distinguishes one person from another. It is an independent concept that represents the person himself. In biblical culture, the name is equivalent to his or her character and mission. In Genesis 32, we know. With regard to Jacob, when a name is changed, that even makes the authority and power of the name giver. Rachel dies calling her child, son of my sorrow. But Jacob calls him Benjamin, changes the name, Benjamin, the son of my right hand. Besides, the name expresses his or her social potential, so that name can also mean renown. In the book of Numbers 16:2. In the Jewish society, it is to be nameless, if there somebody is nameless, is to be considered worthless. In the theological realm, and you shall no longer be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham, Genesis 17:5. In the political realm, and the king of Babylon appointed Mattaniah, Joachim's uncle, king in his place, changing his name to Zedekiah, 2 Kings 24:17. And in the geographical realm, and they named the town Dan, as their ancestor Dan, who was Israel's son, we find in Judges 18:29. The naming marks control and transition. Scholars note Genesis 2:20-23 as an example of power of naming as an act of control as well as an act of completion of creation. Also, a name indicates one's personality, and so a change of name is a change of personality. When God changes the name of Abram, Sarai, and Jacob into Abraham, Sarah, and Israel, and given them a new name, it indicates that God is in control of them and changes the course of life for them, giving them a new occasion to follow his design. Now, the significance of Joseph, husband of Mary. Joseph naming child Jesus is closely linked to a command of God to Joseph. Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. Matthew 1:20. As per the Jewish custom, Joseph was only engaged to Mary and he had not completed the full marriage process. We know from Matthew and Luke infancy narratives, the formal exchange of consent before witnesses, and as Joachim Jeremias observes, the subsequent taking of the bride to the groom's home is also over. Yes, with this consent, the man has a right over the girl, and thus can be called in our term husband and wife. Indeed, it is clear explicitly in Matthew and implicitly in Luke from the verse 134, how can this be since I am a virgin? So implicitly in Luke that Joseph and Mary were in the stage of matrimonial procedure before the two steps. During this period, Joseph comes to know that Mary is pregnant in Luke and, or Matthew in infancy narratives. But neither the society nor Joseph know how she conceived. He is confused. Being a just man, he is resolved to settle this situation smoothly. At this moment, the command of God comes to him. Take Mary as your wife. Of course, Joseph is told that she conceived by the Holy Spirit, a supernatural miracle. Joseph's confusion disappeared. Here, God himself fulfills the second stage of their marriage, and Joseph, by accepting Mary as her wife, as his wife, publicly giving, publicly gives her the full status of a wife. The facts of Mary's virginity, the cause of her being with the child, are known only to Mary and Joseph, and Joseph becomes fully the legal husband of Mary by accepting Mary as his wife. Therefore, it is to be noted that Joseph and Mary living in Nazareth, the Galilean environment of that time, the fear of Roman soldiers' atrocities, betrothed couples were allowed to have matrimonial relationship. So, when Mary conceives, there is no public scandal. We have to underline this one. People thought it is normal relationship between Mary and Joseph that Mary is conceived. However, God has not only cleared the mind of Joseph, but also led him to the second stage of marriage, taking Mary as his wife. Now, we come to the other next important point. Joseph named him Jesus. Point number 8. God, through his angel, commanded Joseph in a dream to name the son begotten by Mary. This is closely linked to an earlier command of God to Joseph. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus. That is given to Mary, that command. In Luke's gospel, it was Mary who was told, "You will name him Jesus." Yes. However, there is a deep significance in asking Joseph to name the child born of Mary. The command is given to Joseph in an apocalyptic manner, an angel speaking to him in a dream. It's an apocalyptic manner. In the infancy narrative, according to Matthew, there are three angelic dreams, dream appearances. Matthew 1:25, 2:13, and 19, three appearances. And two supplementary divine communications also in Matthew 2:12 and 22. However, as Raymond Brown noted, these dreams are not like the apocalyptic dreams in Daniel or in Book of Revelation, puzzles that need an interpreter, nor do the dreams themselves carry the revelation. You must remember, they are simply a context for the angel of the Lord who conveys the message of God. We find the same parallel situations in Acts 16:9, also in other places. Now, because of Joseph naming him Jesus, what are the consequences? Social status is given for Jesus. So also, Joseph knows fairly well that the child was born of Mary is not his physical child. If there is no legal father, there is no social status for the child. Now comes the second command of God. Joseph, son of David, you are to name him Jesus. Matthew 1:21. Among the Palestinian Jews, it was either the father or the mother who named the child at his birth. In Genesis 4:25, we will see. Esau and Jacob were named by both parents, Isaac and Rebekah, while Adam, Abraham, named their children. The patriarchal mothers, yes, like Leah and Rachel, out of extreme joy, named their children. However, Jacob renamed his last son Benjamin, who was already named as Ben-Oni by his dying mother Rachel. Clear evidence is seen in the case of John the Baptist. The relatives wanted to confirm with Zechariah the name proposed by Elizabeth. Even in naming Jesus, Matthew and Luke differ. According to Matthew's account, It was Joseph who was asked to name the child. Whereas according to Luke, Mary is asked to name the child. Therefore, it is evident that naming a child in ancient Palestine is not the prerogative of the father only. Nevertheless, in this case, why was Joseph asked to name the child? Now, Matthew had two main reasons why he brought Joseph to name the child. According to his conviction and faith of the early Christianity, Mary brought forth the child through the power of the Holy Spirit. There is no doubt in it. Joseph had no place in it. However, this firstborn child, in the social perspective, must have a father so that this child would be the legal child of this family of Joseph and Mary. Therefore, Joseph, by coming forward to name this child, accepts to be the legal father of the child. By the command of God, he took Mary as his wife, now took the child as his own. He is not just a foster father. Some would think foster father, people talk about it. It is not true. But in the Jewish legal sense, a real father. In line with Matthew, Luke also underlines the fatherhood of Joseph, as so much is so, Mary could tell Jesus, "Your father and I have been searching for you with great anxiety in the temple." She was telling Jesus. And at the synagogue of Nazareth, people wonder, "Is this not the son of Joseph?" By which Luke pays special attention to Joseph as Jesus' father. Second motive of Matthew is, in my opinion, much more than the aforesaid. It is only a theological reason for Matthew to account Joseph naming child Jesus. It is a prevalent view in the New Testament that Jesus became son of David either at his baptism or at his resurrection. Romans 1:4 or Matthew 1:9 we see that. For Matthew and Luke, Jesus' human parentage is also important. In the genealogy, Matthew, as noted above, very clearly presents the place of Jesus as a son of Joseph, descended from David and son of God, born to a virgin. Moreover, Matthew is careful to note that the angel, before expressing the two commands addressed to Joseph, son of David, Joseph was addressed as son of David. Luke also, in his infancy narratives, very vividly links Joseph with David. In the Annunciation account, he notes, "A man whose name was Joseph of the house of David." And when mentioning about the origin of Joseph, he says, "Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David." Luke 2:4. When Joseph, son of David, names the child, that child Jesus becomes the son of David. He is from the lineage of Abraham and David. As we find many witnesses from the other books of the New Testament, Jesus' Davidic heritage was already an accepted faith of the early church. B.M. Nolan, in his book, The Royal Son of God, notes that Matthew, a Jewish Christian and probably Aramaic, and his followers were among the first Christian community in touch with the first century Judaism. And so this gospel underlines the Jewish tradition and the way of life. Key writing for the Jewish Christian, Matthew, writing for the Jewish Christians, the Jewish tradition, the very carefully establishes in the infancy narratives itself how Jesus historically became the son of David, in order to prove that Jesus is the expected Davidic Messiah. Joseph naming the child Jesus is not only asserts the fact that Jesus is his legal son, but he is also son of David. Matthew alone, among the evangelists, evinces a key interest in Jesus as the son of David. It is clear in Matthew that Jesus had a genealogical claim to the title son of David. It is clear that he passed the test of his spiritual claim to the title. It is clear that he was popularly acclaimed as the son of David. In short, it is clear from this point in Matthew that Jesus had the credentials which qualified him to be called the son of David. Thus, Matthew thereby confirms the faith of the early Christianity that Jesus is the son of David, hence he is the Davidic Messiah. According to Matthew, it is Joseph who plays a vital role in Jesus fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel. Matthew 1:22, Isaiah 7:14. Raymond Brown argues that Matthew is interested in interpreting the term Emmanuel as God with us because it helps to support Jesus' divine sonship alongside his Davidic sonship. Moreover, it enables him to set an inclusion at the end of the gospel of Jesus, says, I am with you all days till the end of the world. Significance of the name Jesus. Matthew writes that Joseph named the child Jesus. It was not Joseph who invented this name. It was already told him by the angel, you are to name him Jesus, for he will save the people from their sins. In the Lucan narrative, this was told to Mary, you have to name him Jesus, Luke 1:31. And accordingly, Joseph and Mary together named him Jesus in Luke's gospel, Luke 2:21. Both together named him. Therefore, the name Jesus is a God-given name, and so basically the father of this child is the heavenly father. That is why there was the revelation from heaven, this is my beloved son, both at Jesus' baptism and at his transfiguration. Again, my dear friends, Matthew interprets this name Jesus as God saves. The audience of Matthew, the Greek-speaking Hebrews, could have been already taught that this name Jesus was coming from Hebrew etymology Joshua, which is further interpreted by Matthew, for he will save his people from their sins. This name Jesus, a salvific name and above any other name, is a Christological confession of the early church, letter to Philemon's, Philippians 2, 9, 11, chapter 2, 9 to 11, we see also in Ephesians, the confession of the early church. It expresses a total transcendence over every creature, and the name Jesus signifies his character and mission. So much so, salvation is found only in this name, John 3:18, also 1 John 5:13. And so, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, Philippians 2:10. Now we come to theological and pastoral relevance. Having considered the event of Joseph naming Jesus in the context of Joseph's relation to Mary at the horizontal level and to the vertical level, let us draw theological and pastoral relevance of this. First of all, we come to know it is an act of faith on Joseph's side. Joseph named this child Jesus was an act of faith. It was Joseph's once and for all surrender, fiat, of Joseph to God, who revealed the name in his dream. Joseph set aside all his plans and priorities and confusions, doubts, everything, so that he would embrace the plans and priorities of God. That is Joseph. We also see by naming Jesus, yes, Joseph exhibits his act of hope. As mentioned earlier, the name Jesus signifies his saving mission on earth. Jesus would become the savior of the world, who would save humankind from sin and perdition. Joseph's naming is an act of hope, for through this he not only initiates the mission of Jesus, but also waits for his completion with patience and perseverance. He never intervened afterwards. According to the gospel accounts, he is silent. His silence means not he is speechless, but he was waiting for the completion of the salvific mission of Jesus. You also see in Joseph naming Jesus his act of love. By naming Jesus, Joseph becomes the legal father of Jesus, no doubt, no doubt. Act of love. And he becomes a custodian of not only Jesus, but of the Holy Family. His responsibility as a loving father commences here. Joseph becomes a father through his self-gift. I quote here Pope Francis, yes, his Patris Corde. It is true, he is a heart of the father. He shows all the events in the infant's narratives, how not only obey the God's command very minutely, but also with love and care. He took care of Jesus and Mary all through the journey of the child from Bethlehem to Egypt, from Egypt to Nazareth. So we see an act of love in this. That's why Pope Francis very, very elaborately describes on this point. And here, Joseph naming Jesus, we see his love. Also, in conclusion, I would like to say, Pope Francis in his apostolic letter, yes, Patris Corde, terms Joseph as an obedient father. An obedient father, yes. Matthew succinctly says in his narrative, infant's narrative, and he did as the angel of the Lord has commanded him. Something very, very clear statement of his obedience, total submission to God's command. But not with a compulsion, but with a choice of gladness also and freedom. His obedience is linked with his uprightness, dikaios in Matthew 1:18, as Abraham's righteousness was associated with his obedience to God's command. We see in Romans 4:2 and also Galatians 3:6, we read, obedience made it possible for him to surrender his difficulties and confusion with regard to Mary, having conceived and the newborn child. In particular, my dear friends, in naming the child Jesus, Joseph becomes the father of the Holy Family and enables to become Jesus, the son of David, yes, enables Jesus that to be the son of David. It is a divine vocation given to Joseph, which he accepted wholeheartedly and fulfilled faithfully. As our dear father theologian Michael Amaldas rightly observes in his article in New Leader, observed that Joseph's consent was not asked, as was the case with Mary at her Annunciation. He is just told what to do and he obeys. That is something total and total surrender to God and also complete obedience, not only obedience, trust in God's word. Total trust in God's word. Whatever comes from God is only good. So I will simply obey God's intuition, God's command. That's what he tells us also. So may the first and foremost obedience of Joseph is exhibited when he takes Mary as his wife and names the child Jesus. The naming Jesus is the fiat of Joseph, I told, explained earlier. His fiat was also a total and radical, that of Mary. This also manifests two important evangelical messages for us. Joseph gave full cooperation to the salvific plan of God. When we hold on to the gospel values and live accordingly, we become agents of God's salvation in the world. For example, during the pandemic, many doctors, nurses, and health workers with much dedication and commitment sacrifice their lives. They become instruments of salvation. When working for justice and giving our life for the downtrodden and the oppressed, as in the case of Father Stan Swami, we become angels of divine mercy and love. Secondly, Saint Joseph, an unknown man from Nazareth, through his total surrender to God, became servant of God's salvific work. Weak as we are, Joseph was not a great known or popular person. So, weak as we are, we also can become somebody of worth, as in the case of St. Peter. Luke 5, we will know. I am a sinner, get away, my Lord, he says. Yes, human frailty will be made strong by the hand of God, Joseph tells us. What is needed is the willingness to sacrifice our own self and uphold what is divine. Saint Joseph, accepting Mary and Jesus as his own wife and child, shines brighter in being the apostle of obedience. So with this, I conclude, I stop. If there is anything else we can discuss, you can also share or ask any other questions. Thank you very much for your listening, and I appreciate all of you for your presence. Thank you.
Now over to the moderator. Moderator could unmute. Yes.
Your Excellency, thank you for the systematic and scholarly presentation. The presentation of His Excellency can be summed up as follows. Who is Joseph? Who is Mary? Who is Jesus? What is the significance of name and naming? What is the importance of this for us today? His Excellency has given a very good portrayal of Saint Joseph as presented in the Gospels and in the Fathers of the Church. Saint Joseph stands before us as a silent saint and an apostle of obedience. Thank you, Your Excellency, for your creative insights and challenging lessons. Now may I invite participants to interact with the speaker. Your interaction could be an appreciation, a review, an addition, or a clarification.
The participants can place your review or comments or questions in the comment box as well.
As the moderator said, your interaction can be also additions, clarifications on your part also. I tried to analyze this text mostly biblically, but also finally I come to the conclusion of theological and also practical pastoral life, but I did not deal very, very elaborately on that level.
Okay, Your Excellency, one question has come from the comment from one user, I issue. That is, question is, where was Saint Joseph when Jesus was crucified?
There is no evidence in the Gospels or in other extra literature from the other Gospels, no mention of Joseph. We don't find anything except in the early stages of Jesus, and Joseph becomes silent. Maybe God designs in that way. Joseph's vocation is to initiate Jesus. We cannot now suppose. Maybe you can also, yes, Father Mike. Yeah.
Father Anand Amaladas.
Anand Amaladas.
Thank you very much for this excellent talk. As I appreciate very much. And I'd like to add a small comment. You know, St. Joseph is honored in Tamil Nadu by our great poet, Veeramma Munivar, by his epic. And he has filled in what was lacking in the gospel narratives. What Joseph did not speak in the gospels, we find very elaborately discussed. And is revealing that Veeramma Munivar Besky has brought to this country a devotion to Joseph and made Joseph is a great figure through his classical epic Tamil poem through which he is known in Tamil world. And in fact, he gave us the Tamil Christian identity by this epic in honoring St. Joseph. It will be nice to link also what happened later on by the missionaries who came here, how the devotion was brought to us is quite alive. Many people remember the poem and the recite verses, and it has created a tradition for ourselves. That's the additional comment I would like to make in this context. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Father. Yes, your popular popularity of Joseph, yes, very much, as you said, was spread or very much written by also Veeramma Munivar, and that became a big incentive for us all to have a complete devotion to St. Joseph. Yes.
Good. Your Excellency, there is another question from Sister Roshina. Will you give little more details on how Jesus became Son of David? This is the question.
Yeah. In short, we can say very, very, very clearly, Matthew very clearly speaks of in his genealogy that Joseph is the son of David. Joseph is the son of Abraham and son of David. Very clearly, he gives the genealogical list. And so, then after finishing the genealogical list, then in the second part of the first chapter of Matthew, he speaks about Joseph linking Jesus or linking Jesus with Joseph. So how? Because Joseph named him Jesus. That means, according to Jewish tradition, naming is accepting him legal father. Even though in the Christian tradition and also in reality, he is not a legal father. Joseph knows he is not a legal father, but because of God's vocation, God's command, we can say, our vocation, we can say, Joseph accepted to name Jesus. By that, Jesus becomes son of David, son of Abraham. So only through the link, through Joseph, Jesus becomes son of David, according to the Matthewan or Lucan tradition. Matthew. That's why we cannot more otherwise talk about that.
Good. Thank you, Your Excellency. Now, another question from Brother Devaputiran Dhanaraj. Can we say that Mary also was a descendant of David?
That point is not very well established by the genealogy, according to Matthew and Luke. And we don't have any extra literature from extra outside Bible that Mary is a descendant of or coming from David. There is no evidence. We cannot say that one also because there is a tradition. Mary is mainly from the Capernaum area, Nazareth area. And Davidic descendants are Judean tribes lived in and around Jerusalem. That is what the biblical history or we say historical data we see.
Good. Anyone else? Very good. Now,
Father Maria Raja and also Jesu,
yes,
arranged this and given me opportunity to share my thoughts with you all, and I hope it is for you something is useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Now may I request Mrs. Philomena Arakyaswamy, the moderator, to wind up the session, after which there will be a short word of thanks.
Thank you, dear fathers, sisters and friends, for the fruitful discussion. The evening has been an hour of learning and sharing. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, dear Mrs. Philomena Arakyaswamy, for moderating the session so well. Thank you for your presence with us, and thank you for introducing us to us, the speaker, and moderating the session. Thank you. Now I take this moment to thank everyone present here. To begin with, let me thank His Excellency, Most Reverend Dr. Anthony Swami Peter Abir, the Chairman of CCBI Commission for Bible, who has consented to collaborate with Jesuit Chennai Province Commission for Dialogue and Spirituality to undertake this webinar series. And especially he has taken himself to deliver this lecture on Joseph naming the child Jesus. Indeed, it was a very scientific paper, scholarly presented with pastoral application. And in our bishop, I find a rare combination of an academician and a pastor. The paper was historical, biblical, theological, socio-cultural, and pastoral. And he not only reflected on Joseph, he made us reflect on Mary and Jesus. Thank you, Your Excellency, for accepting to deliver this paper. Thank you, Your Excellency.
Thank you.
I thank Mrs. Philomena Arakyaswamy, the moderator of the day. When we were looking for a person who would have a different outlook towards St. Joseph, Father Maria Raja proposed to me the name of Mrs. Philomena Arakyaswamy, who has been the constant contributor on YouTube and blog. And I thank her. So she plays a key role in my life as well. I found St. Joseph at Jnanolipuram, and I found Mr. Arakyaswamy's family also at Jnanolipuram. They are my second parents and they constantly accompany me. And I take this moment to thank Mr. Arakyaswamy and Mrs. Philomena Arakyaswamy personally for guiding me all along. And I wish and pray that through this floor, that through the intercession of St. Joseph, may you enjoy good health of body and mind, and God bless you. And thank you for consenting to be the moderator, and thank you for doing the job very well. Thank you, dear Amma. Thank you.
Make me very emotional.
Raja, the director of the Jesuit Chennai Province Commission for Dialogue and Spirituality, for the welcome speech and for continuing to help me in arranging this program. And my special thanks to Fathers Michael Amaladas, Father Michael Alosanai, Father Anand Amaladas, Mrs. Catherine from US, and students from our online Bible college, Mr. Savarinathan, Brother Deva Putiran, Sister Soundari, and a YouTuber, AnbiumTube, and many others who were present here and whose names were familiar. And today I'm able to see many faces, especially Father Anand Amaladas' face. So thank you, Father. And Father has been a great support to me personally for my academic work. Thank you. I take this moment to thank all of you. And I thank everybody for your presence here with us for this learning session. And also does not stand as a learning as well, but that we take this further. And now the next session, it's an announcement, will be on the topic, Jesus, the image of the Father. The talk will be delivered by Father Navin Ribello, a SVD priest from Rome. Now, may I request His Excellency to grant us the blessing and conclude the session.
Heavenly Father, bless us all gathered in this webinar. We thank you and praise you for Saint Joseph having given us a model for all the Christian virtues. And we also thank you for giving us the great devotion to Saint Joseph, who always protects us, who always intercedes for us, who always be with us. And you have given us an opportunity to meditate great insights of Saint Joseph through the Gospel revelations. Also, we thank for all the participants of this webinar, that they may be inspired by Saint Joseph. We also thank and praise you for all the organizers and also for all the people who are very much involved in giving us talks and also in organizing this webinar for the benefit of a lot of people, both not only Christians, also not non-Christians. So we earnestly request you to shower upon us your Holy Spirit through the intercession of Saint Joseph and our Divine Mother. And Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Your Excellency. Thank you, dear fathers, and thank you, dear sisters. Thank you, brothers. And thank you for making this evening beautiful and memorable. Thank you.